welcome you, Mfundisi. We welcome you once again. Take us over to the other side. Thank you.
Good morning, Pastor Machaya. Good morning to the 5 a.m. gang. Good morning to everyone that is listening to this virtual prayer. It has indeed been a very, very, very quick week. I must say, when I first got this request, I knew I could not refuse. But at the same time, I was thinking, 5 a.m., how am I going to do this? And for the past week, I've been waking up at 4 a.m. every day. But it has been surprisingly very easy, because when we are in God, we can do all things through Christ. And I'm really thankful that I was invited to this program. Today is going to be the penultimate. Tomorrow, we will be having our last sermon or word together. But today we are going to be dealing with Mark chapter 4, verse 40. And then tomorrow we will close off the pericope with Mark chapter 4, verse 41. Maybe you can allow me to read our pericope in your hearing. In the book of Mark, chapter 4, I read from you from verse 35. That day when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up, and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care if we drown?" He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." Then the wind died down and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the winds and the waves, they obey him." May the good Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word, and let it be so until he comes. Amen. Brothers and sisters, this morning we are dealing with verse 40. Chapter 4, verse 40. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" If you will all remember, preceding this verse is the verse where Jesus arose from his sleep and he quieted down the storm that was attacking at the disciples. And after everything was calm, he now turns to his disciples and he addresses them and says, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" Then now, when Jesus is addressing the disciples, the storm has already ceased. When Jesus is addressing the disciples, everything is calm. When Jesus addresses the disciples, there is nobody that is in panic, because the reason for their panic has been removed by Jesus from them. And I'd like to say this morning, how I wish we can deal with God's children the same way that God deals with his children. For when there's a brother or a sister that is erring in any way possible, it is very important that we do not jump at the throats of the people, but rather jump at the throat of the problem of the people, so that when we deal with them, they can be in a calm state, knowing that the brothers do care and they do show love. Many people have walked out of our doors because of the way we've treated them when they were in situations that showed lack of faith, that showed weakness in their situation. But this morning, Jesus shows us a very good example that when you rise up from a situation, don't go dealing with the man, deal with the devil that was behind the man so that the man can be saved. It doesn't matter what the situation is, but first we need to deal with the uncalm spirit that was behind the issue before we come to the man. Brothers and sisters, I'd like to say we do not fight against flesh and blood, but we fight against the principalities of darkness. And because of that, we will miss the issues if we focus on people instead of focusing on the issues that got them here. I would love to see a church that when they see a pregnant somebody, they come to them and they say to them, "Child, we sympathize with you. We do not know what has happened. What are you going to do with the baby? Do you have clothing? Do you have everything that you need? What is your situation at home? Deal with all of the issues so that when there's calm, you can come back and say, but you do know that this that you have done might have brought a witness to others as well." I'm saying to you, brothers and sisters, we need to treat each other with love. That is what Jesus does. He looks at the situation arises as though the disciples are not there, as though the disciples have not shown panic, as though the disciples are not afraid. And he deals with the situation as though it's a master that is doing exactly what is needed by the disciples. But at the end, when everything is calm, he turns around and he says, "Why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith?" The issue here is that I have performed everything in front of you. There is nothing that you did not witness. You saw my power as I exercised it over demons. You saw my power as I exercised it with the sick. You saw my power as I exercised it with everyone that was in front of you. Yet you are still afraid. Brothers and sisters, Jesus is revealing a very important aspect here, that he has not come to this world so that he can be Father Christmas. He has not come to this world so that he can be Superman. For it's Father Christmas that comes and he puts parcels for you every time that you request. He says the healing, he says the exercising, he says everything that I performed, I did not do it so that you can have a lighter yoke, but I did it so that you can believe that I have the power that is able to do everything possible to save you from your situation. Therefore, I'd like to say to you, my brother, just because you have not been saved from your infirmity does not mean God does not care for you, but he's not in the business of producing bread when people are hungry, but he's in the business of producing salvific power when people need salvation. Therefore, you will get bread when it is to your salvation. But if it is not to your salvation, forget about the bread. What you need to appreciate is that you are in the company of the Master. Paul says, "Three times I've come to the Lord. Three times I begged him to remove the pain that is on my side. Oh, but there was only one answer. My grace is sufficient for you." What is grace? Grace is the unmerited favor that we receive from Jesus. The fact that God can be with us is the favor that should make us say, if then he's with us, who can be against us? Brothers and sisters, I'm here to say this morning that we should not come to God expectant, but we should come to God already received, for he has done enough at the cross. Everything else that follows, it is just a bonus. Why are you still afraid? Do you still have no faith? After everything, why are you afraid? Things are coming wrong. Things are becoming bad. Your situation is not improving. The kids are wayward. The marriage is on the brink of divorce. Everything is not going right. Your house is about to be foreclosed. But Jesus is asking this morning, have I not done enough for you? Have I not done enough for you to believe that I am able to carry you? Even if the house is taken, even if the kids go astray, even if the marriage ends, even if things go bad, yet we will still trust in him because we've been given this favor of being in the company of the heavenly king. Ellen White says to us this morning, we have nothing to fear for the future, lest we forget who God has been in the past. Brothers and sisters, there's a reason why we should worship God when things are falling apart. Worship God when things are not going our way. Worship God even though things are not as we desired. For it is through worship that we remind ourselves of who God has been in our lives in the past. Many times we have gone with this God through difficult situation, but it is as though when we meet a new situation, it is as though God has never performed anything in our lives. Brothers and sisters, we need to take from those moments of grace when God appeared to be closer than a brother, and we should hold on to those so that we can make it through and navigate when periods become difficult. We cannot come knocking every time, crying out to God as though we have no faith. Let us show appreciation for the master and say, hey, I need no other evidence. I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died for me. Brothers and sisters, we need Christians today that say that no matter what can come, even if the devil can do his way, even if God cannot come to my rescue, yet I will trust in him. That was Job's word when he said, though he slay me, meaning that even though I do not understand the cause for my bereavement, yet I have no other option, I will trust in him. That is the demand that heaven is putting across for us. Jeremiah comes through and he says, it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, for his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Oh, brothers and sisters, in the Hebrew, when they're talking about compassions, they use a root word that is talking about the woman's womb. They use the same root word for compassions. The reason why they use that is evidently seen when we go to court and we look at a gangster, a big monster that was terrorizing society, and we're busy saying to the courts, no bail. We say to the courts, make sure you throw away the key. And we see a woman coming through uncooked food and coming and sneaking the food to them. And we ask ourselves, what is this woman doing? Why are they giving this guy food after all of the atrocious things that he has done? And the woman says, I am so sorry that I have to do this, but it is because of the bad pangs that make me bring this food for his child. I know that he has done wrong. I know that he's a monster. Oh, but because of the bad pangs, he is still my child, and I still need to take care of them. Brothers and sisters, this is the same connotation that the Hebrews were looking at when they were looking at the compassions of God. They were saying that we are not deserving. They were saying that there's no reason for God to show us mercies each morning. But because of the pangs of knowing that we are his children, because of the responsibility of saying, even though we are bad, yet he, as our parent, is still responsible for us. Those compassions, they make him flow with new mercies each morning. Therefore, no matter how bad we have been, no matter how disgusting we have been, God is ever faithful to welcome us back into his loving arms so that he can pour us a new dose of mercy and a new dose of compassion. Brothers and sisters, allow me to say, had it not been for the Lord, we would have been deeply consumed by our troubles. Had it not been for the Lord, the devil would have consumed us. Had it not been for the Lord, we would have even killed ourselves, but because of the Lord's compassions, we gain new power each morning. Brothers and sisters, why are you still afraid when God has done so much for you? Look back to where you first met him. Look back at your situation. Look back at how God has led you in the past. I know who I could have been had God not come through in my life. Hey, remember, at some point in my life, I was not only Pastor Mabenge, but I was Bra X. But because of his love and compassion, because of his mercy, today I have a new word. And every time I look at my past, I say it could only have been God that was able to rescue me and turn my life around. I remember when Pastor Babu met with me in Fenton Church and I was coming through just to drop off a friend. Hey, I had a 20s pack of Peter Stuyvesant in my pocket. But the day I listened to a sermon that was coming from his servant saying that we are the salt of the world, I had been trying to give up smoking for a long time. But that day I had power like I've never had before, for I immediately threw my cigarettes away and I have never looked back again. I say to you, the power is not upon what we can do for ourselves, but the power is upon the mercies of heaven that keep on relentlessly coming after us so that we can be rescued from our situations. What do you have to say to these things today? If then God is for us, who can be against us? Brothers and sisters, Pastor Katlane, let me give a shout out to the man of God this morning. He has a wonderful, wonderful illustration that he did for us when I was still president of the VOP at Helderberg College. I was called to the office after we had planned to have an evangelistic campaign with Pastor Katlane. And I was asked, brother, can you please explain? There's a topic here that says, there's a man in the bedroom. We are going to have visitors here. We cannot have things that are going to embarrass us. I went to Pastor Katlane and I said, Pastor Katlane, are you sure about this topic? Because we have top people coming through. And Pastor Katlane said, let the top people come. They will hear about the man in the bedroom. And the story goes like this, that this man was in love with this girl. And they were so in love, but the guy was a guy that was a criminal that would jump counters and he would go and get his money that way. He went there to go and try and get money for his wedding, for his lobola. But he got caught and he was sentenced to 18 years. But because of good behavior, he came out after 10 years of his sentence. And when he came out, there's no other place where he wanted to go except to go meet his first love, the one whom he got arrested trying to make lobola for. And as he went to the address, he was thinking about the memories and how good it's going to be when they are reunited together. But when he got there, they told him that the woman does not stay there anymore. He searched and searched until he got her new address. He went to the address and he knocked at the door. After 10 years of not seeing his love, after 10 years of not seeing the one that was the object of his memories whilst he was in prison, he comes and he knocks at the door. And lo and behold, there is his woman opening the door, ever full of love, ever beautiful, ever the same way that he had imagined her for 10 years. And immediately when she saw him, she was full of love. And that love came back inside of her. She opened up the door wide. She hugged him. She embraced him. She gave him a very, very, very solid kiss. And after the kiss, she pushed him back and closed the door. Because during that kiss, she remembered that there is another man that is in the bedroom. Whilst the guy was serving the 10 years, the woman fell in love with somebody else. And because of that, she had married and moved on with her life. Even though she still had another husband that she needed to deal with that was in the bedroom. Brothers and sisters, I would like to say this morning that we too suffer from the man in the bedroom syndrome, because even though Jesus has done enough, even though Jesus comes through enough for us, yet we leave him, we push him away, because we realize that we still have a man in the bedroom. What is the man in the bedroom? It is all the sins that we're not willing to let go of. What is the man in the bedroom? It is the unbelief that we harbor, even though Jesus has done so much for us. Don't push Jesus away. He is your first love. He is the one that you're supposed to do with. Leave the man in the bedroom. Go with the Lord, for it is him that gives you compassion, that gives you mercy. Brothers and sisters, I'm here to say this morning, Jesus has done enough in Calvary. Jesus has done enough in our lives. Jesus has done enough in our situations. Jesus has rescued us enough. Let us not treat him like Father Christmas. Let us not treat him like Superman, but let us treat him like the Savior that he is, so that we do not need to be reminded. But one writer says, because I'm human, I need to be reminded by you, O Lord. Remind me of where we come from. And this morning I say that we need to remember where we come from with this Lord, so that the new mercies can be meaningful in our lives. Why are you still afraid? Why do you still lack faith? God is calling for us to come to a higher standard, to cross over from where we were, to a place where he can be able to communicate with us. May God bless us. May God be in our situations that we're in. And may we say this morning that truly, because we have seen how God has led us, we need not panic in our new situations. Let us pray together. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for everything you've done for us. Help us to remember, Lord, how good you have been to us in the past. Help us to remember, Father, the worst situations that we've gone past. Help us to remember, Lord, when we lost loved ones and we felt as though the world was coming to an end, and yet we have new power today to walk around. Help us to remember, Lord, when things almost got out of our hand, but because we called upon your name, you came through for us. And let those, Lord, hold us through as we are walking through the current problems, so that we can say, even if he does not come through for me, yet I will not bow down to any other God except to this God. Thank you, Father, for the new mercies. Each morning, even though we're not deserving, yet you still come through for us. You're a good God. You're a great God. And you deal with us very kindly. Father, there's somebody breaking out there because, Father, in their situation, they are saying that, Lord, just this last time, take it away. I pray this morning that just for the sake of your miraculous work for this week's ministry, Father, take it away, take the chain away, so that they can believe, so that they can have faith. We pray, Lord, that you may increase our belief. Yes, Lord, we do believe, but help our unbelief at the same time. Thank you, Father, for being a good God, and bless us even today in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.